This is a very timely top eight. This is going to be the top eight breakout cards from Pro Tour Eldritch Moon. This is a good one. I have to say, Paul, you carried the mail on this one. You banged out a list for us very quickly, very, very efficiently. So thank you very much. Before we dive too far into the top eight, I want to remind you that Magic TV and all of our Magic TV top eights are brought to you by ChannelFireball.com, where, as I mentioned at the open, we are currently pre-selling Conspiracy 2. Cannot stress enough that Conspiracy 2 crate. If you need to know more about it, watch the video to start the show when I was rapidly talking for 10 minutes while we were getting Paul's sound ready. But that channel Fireball, Conspiracy 2 crate is amazing. If you're going to buy one box of Conspiracy, not 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, but if you're only going to buy one box of the Conspiracy 2, get the crate instead. The value is insane. Trust me, I'm not just trying to upsell you here. For 20 bucks more, you get so much good stuff. You got to do it. It's a no-brainer.
Yeah.
I looked at it, I was like, is this a mistake? I was actually in Channel Fireball President and CEO John Sasso's office, and I was like, is this a mistake? Because it seems like a lot of value for 20 extra bucks. So check it out on the website right now, Conspiracy 2 Crate for $120, or if you just need a box of Conspiracy 2, say, nah, Mash, I'm good, I'll just take the box, on there for $100.
So I kind of want to clarify just kind of some of the cards on the list. It's cards that we didn't quite, like, they were kind of like sleepers.
Sleepers.
Yeah.
Sleepers.
We didn't quite expect them. We weren't sure. Like, they were powerful cards.
Sure.
But we weren't quite sure how they would perform
mm-hmm.
At the Pro Tour. And, you know, this is kind of like a collection of eight cards that I felt like, you know, were the kind of the breakout cards of the Pro Tour. I do have an honorable mention, though.
Honorable mention us.
This one has to be mentioned because
it's so bad.
This is it's such...
It's good. It's good.
I mean, you look at the card and you're like, oh my God, why is...
It's unbelievable. How does this card make
And Matt Nash built many different decks with this, trying to make it work, but couldn't figure it out a way. And that is Thermo Alchemist. My honorable card is Thermo Alchemist. Pedro Carvalho went 9-1
right.
with the blue-red burn deck that featured a Thermo Alchemist in his deck. And I believe he might have been the only one to do well with this deck. Mm-hmm. But the fact that he went 9-1 with this deck is pretty ridiculous, which is why it had to be mentioned, the Thermo Alchemist.
Thermo Alchemist, by the way, it's the Goblin Sharpshooter, right? If you cast instant or sorcery, it untaps, and you can tap to do one damage to target player.
Yes.
So, you know, you can kind of machine gun a player. Back in my day, you could machine gun a bunch of creatures, too.
No, that's too good.
With the Sharpshooter. But it was pretty good. Great art on it. Thermo Alchemist, of course, yes. I thought you were going to mention Gnarls Barkley. I thought you were going
you
with
You can
Gnarls
do that.
No. I'm
going
to go with an honorable mention. It's not a sleeper because I didn't sleep on it. Liliana. The Last Hope.
Come on.
She was amazing.
That card's clearly good, though.
She was amazing. Was it, though? People were banging on me for calling that a good card during the previous season.
No, we both said it was a good card.
I didn't say you. I didn't point at you. I didn't point at you. I pointed at the audience.
It's a three-mana play.
That's a three-mana. Hey, Tybalt's a two-mana Planeswalker. I didn't do anything. But
I like to honorable mention Collected Company. Very powerful magic card.
Dude, Liliana, you didn't think Liliana was as good as it was.
I wasn't good. I didn't think it was going to be this popular.
Yeah, I mean, it was everywhere. She was rampant. Great job, Lily. I never doubted you for a second. Let's dive into it. Coming in at number eight, Grapple with the Past.
Yeah.
This card's great. I mean, it's you know, kind of like a regrowth by any other name is still a regrowth here.
Yeah, but this kind of just like does everything you kind of want. It kind of helps smooth out your draws. It'll get you your land. It helps build Delirium.
Yeah.
Instant speed. And it gets back your biggest threat, too. It also helps you mill Kozilek's Return. It's just a really elegant card. It just gets exactly what you need, gets the job done. And, you know, very, very rarely misses.
Yeah, I love, and part of it is because it doesn't have to be anything you mill, right? You mill first, and then you can take the whole yard and get
whatever
you want.
Yeah, that's the really important
thing. And
that's
the huge part, right? You don't have to get lucky with those four. I mean, it's good to get lucky with those four, but you have the whole yard to look at.
Right.
And this is part of, Grapple with the Past is part of what shaped this format, shaped this environment, and really enabling Delirium. I love what you said. It's definitely elegant because it solves so many problems at once. It gives you
also,
so much access.
Also, very undervalued in drafts still. You guys should be taking this a little higher.
All right, what's your pick range for Grapple with the Past?
I mean, I've taken it like fourth pick before. So.
Wow. Yeah. Okay. As high as number four.
It's very,
Big
very
Worm
good.
Agrees. He likes Grapple with the Past. Yeah. I haven't drafted this set, so I got nothing here. Number seven, we talked about earlier on Magic TV, Collective Defiance. Yeah. Now, I have to admit, I was down on this card. Did I like this card? I can't remember. I think I was medium on this card.
I'm not sure, but since it top eighted, I think I was high on this.
I think my biggest issue with it is sorcery, right? And I was like, well, if this card was instant, you know, we might do something. Okay, four damage to a creature, three damage to a player, or you can Winds of Change target player. You know, force target player to pitch their hand and draw that many, or use yourself if you have, you know, as we discussed earlier, ramp spells that you no longer need.
Yeah, and this just kind of proves that, like, just having a card that just gives you flexibility is really important, right? Because you look at this and you're like, all right, 3 mana, 4 damage sorcery, that's kind of mediocre. Mm-hmm. 3 damage to a player, come on, that's pretty bad.
Yeah.
But then that last ability is actually quite strong.
Which is weird.
And that's the important thing.
It sounds weak. Like, yeah, Winds of Change is not really a
right,
thing,
but you're
right?
only paying one extra mana to do this.
That's the best part, right?
Right?
You're just tacking it on.
Because you're not spending that card. Because most of the time, what you're going to be doing is killing a creature. So spend one more mana, discard your hand, boom. You get to reload, right?
Yeah, yep.
Also, sometimes, you know, planeswalkers might be in danger of ultimating. You get to kind of keep it down,
yep.
Which is kind of the main mode because you're playing a ramp deck. You're not looking to
you're
burn
not looking
your
to
opponent.
Blow out creatures,
right. But, I mean, it just gives you enough, kind of flexibility, which is why I think it had so much success the way that it did.
Definitely a sleeper.
Because I had no idea this was going to be playable.
Same here. Our number 6 card, we've already talked about how we both very much underestimated how good this card is. Grim Flayer.
Yeah.
It's 2 mana, 2/2, but that is a 2 mana, 4/4.
Yeah.
And so quick.
That's the thing. When I looked at this card, I think my fault or my problem was just the fact that I was looking at the last set and, you know, just kind of looking at how difficult it was to get Delirium. Mm-hmm. But now, with Grim Flayer, with Liliana, with Grapple, Delirium is pretty easy to get.
Yeah, the engine is there.
Right.
The engine is there, right? You can make it happen.
Not to mention just the fact that it also interacts favorably with Liliana, right? You're playing this Delirium deck. You know, Liliana helps you with Delirium. If the Grim Flayer trades off or dies, you can get it back with the Liliana.
Right, right. No,
it just has so many like nice little synergies built in, which is kind of why green-black was, you know, a functional deck.
It's a very fun-looking deck. If you haven't taken a look at the list,
The Rock.
I love The Rock. Yeah. There's no Rock in the green-black deck, though, is there?
No.
I don't think there's an actual Rock for history's sake in the deck. Number five, and there's so many ways that number five almost feels like it should be number one, just because how out of nowhere, just in terms of like, if you had to look at these cards and their actual like relative value and how good they are in constructed formats,
right.
I feel like number five, you'd be like, how the heck? Coming in at number five, Pilgrim's Eye.
Yeah.
And we talked about earlier in the show, this card was, it's not a great card. It's not like, oh my God, this card's busted. But it's so good.
It's a role player.
But it is like an amazing role
player,
right?
It's the sixth man of that deck.
It really is, though.
Yeah.
I hate making comments like this because I'm just going to get blown up on how wrong I am. But there is a way, I'm not saying it's as good. Okay, Big Worm, you heard me, right? Paul, listen to me. I'm not saying it's as good, but there is a way that this kind of feels like Sacro Tribe Elder. In the sense that it gets you a land, it accelerates you into your next creature.
That's Primo Druid.
Sure.
But Primo Druid's harder to turn on.
Because ultimately, look, Sacro Tribe Elder, what does it do? It just dies. It's a speed bump. It gets you a land, and it's a speed bump. It dies. This card gets you a land, and it's a speed bump, gets another creature.
Yeah, but it doesn't ramp you. It's like a Civic Wayfinder.
It kind of ramps you because you emerge with it.
Yes. I guess, you know what?
Yeah.
In that sense, it makes sense. But yeah, it was really funny. Like I said before, you know, I looked at this card. Paul Rietzel was playing it in this Emerge deck.
At
the first round of the Pro Tour. And I'm just like, I'm trying to justify why he's playing it. I'm like, you know, I guess Selfless Spirit is a card and it interacts favorably. That's why Paul's playing it. That's why. He's emerging Elder Deep Fiends and doing other silly things.
It's so good against Selfless Spirit.
Yeah. I would never have guessed Pilgrim's Eye to also be in the top 8 of the Pro Tour, but here we are.
Yeah, and it's good. I mean, give it a chance. Play the deck.
Also, it's an artifact creature, which is very relevant.
Which is great for Delirium. So, you know, definitely check out your Pilgrim's Eye. All right, this is an interesting top 8. Pause now, as we do. We're halfway through. What cards do you think are in the top half of this top 8? Top 8 sleeper breakouts from Pro Tour Eldritch Moon. You may think, well, these bottom 4 are awful. Why do these guys even talk about it? But that's part of the point. What do you think finished in our 1, 2, 3, 4 slots here?
People went deep.
Mm-hmm.
People went deep with some of these brews. I really appreciate it.
SCE is the best roadblock ramper of all time.
Yeah, Tribalder is great.
Look. I'm going to say this. Pilgrim's Eye is clearly not a roadblock ramper because you can't block with the darn thing. You need it to be there so you can sack it next turn.
Oh, yeah.
I like it. Pilgrim's Eye, the new Sacro Tribe Elder. Yeah, it's a new STE. Yeah, fine. You're gonna paint me into that corner.
Not even close.
Let's see. Ooh. All right, for those of you watching on channelfireball.com, I hope you've taken some time. You hit pause. You wrote your list in the comments. We'll check that out. But now, we're going to embark on our remaining four. Coming in at number four, Elder Deep Fiend.
Yeah, I mean, we had to have an Emerge creature on
definitely,
here.
Definitely.
So it could have been Wretched Griff, but I mean, Elder Deep Fiend is so much better.
Yes, it is.
Also, you know, it was one of those cards where we were like, man, this is a really, really powerful effect, but we're not really sure if this is going to have a home. Like, is somebody going to figure it out? Because, mm-hmm. you know, you look at you know, all the tournament results prior to the Pro Tour, nobody had this card.
Sure.
Nobody was
definitely
really messing not. Around I mean, with
no
Elder Deep Fiend.
No one was doing much with Emerge, period.
Yeah, despite the fact that this card is clearly very, very good.
Right, right.
So, yeah, I mean, you know, we had to put an Emerge card, and Elder Deep Fiend was the one. I mean, this thing just, I saw Owen just obliterate so many different people with this card. Just mm-hmm. being able to just instantly trigger Kozlik's Return is just ridiculous.
Yeah, it's insane. It's insane.
Yeah.
For the record, we are not staying on Eldritch Moon only, so open it up to anything. It doesn't have to be like Moon, just sleeper cards that emerge from this Pro Tour.
Yeah, Pilgrim's Eye. It was Battle for Zendikar.
Oh, yeah. Someone was asking that in the... Yeah.
Or you. Eternal Masters, whichever
version you have. All right. Coming in at number three, Traverse the Ulvenwald.
Yeah.
Unbelievable. Obviously, we talked a lot. This is a card... This is, and we talk about this all the time on Magic TV, where there was an obvious power level here with this card. But it was something that, you know, you mentioned before how Matt Nass was trying to break this card forever. So many players were looking at this card, trying to find ways to break this card. It wasn't possible until Eldritch Moon, because guess what? You need Delirium to make this card busted.
Yeah. Before, we tried to make this card work, and it was just really difficult. We were just going through so many hoops and whatnot to try mm-hmm. to get this card to work. Now you just put it in your grapple deck, and it's pretty easy.
It goes, yeah.
Yeah, and you're able to turn it on, and it's just absolutely absurd. You know, it's in a ton of the various green black Delirium decks, and it just gets you everything. It's just one mana tutor in these decks.
Well, it's great because it's like, you know, in the early game, if you need an early land drop, you can burn it then if you want to. I mean, obviously, you want to wait, because once you hit Delirium, it's basically a demonic tutor.
It also lets you cheat on lands, which is awesome,
yeah.
right?
Because you can,
you know, which was why I was
Pilgrim's Eye too.
Right, which is why I was a little surprised Pantheon didn't have any of these in their deck, because I'm just like, yeah, this is the reason to play like 21 or 22 lands, because you just have it. Allows you to, you know, curve
out. Smooths out your draws.
Yeah, yeah, smooths out your draws. And then at the end game, you can just go ahead and, you know, fetch your Emrakul or whatever.
Yeah. No, it's a phenomenal card. Another role player, but so powerful when you hit it. The delirium feel to it is so, so powerful. Number one and number two. A lot of people have guessed this. Coming in at number two, Kozilek's Return. We knew. I mean,
He's back.
I feel awful because I was pushing this card so hard. I kept saying how good this card was when Shadows was out and how amazing it is. This card's so good. Blah 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 blah. And you know, didn't do anything.
It was good. It was a good card.
It was fine.
It was fine.
Good is like I think almost selling it too much too.
No. I think it was pretty good in the ramp deck. But yeah, it wasn't as easy to kind of trigger those, and you had to like wait a little bit longer to kind of get it off with the Worldbreaker. Now the fact that you can just emerge creatures and just, once again, Elder Deep Fiend plus Kozlik's Return is so dirty.
Whatever doesn't die is tapped, and you don't have any more creatures, I'll just tap whatever other
And you just have this gigantic creature on the battlefield. So Kozlik's Return stock has risen tremendously. It's made cards like Wretched Griff a playable card
definitely.
In Standard.
Oh, definitely. I mean, anything you can emerge into and bring that Kozilek's Return into play and just wipe the board and keep going, it's unbelievable. Like I said, we knew during Battle Block that this was a good card. We knew it was like something that was going to see play, but it just didn't seem to find a home. And now it has a home, and boy, does it have a home. It's pretty unbelievable.
I mean, this is like almost the equivalence of... this is just like casting like... I don't know, like a Desolation Angel or something, right?
You're
just casting a giant flyer and destroying the entire board for not that much of a cost. You're just milling yourself and you just have a free return. And a lot of the time, this return is just getting like a creature or two when you first cast it.
Maybe it's like Desolation Giant.
Sorry, Desolation Giant. That's the one. Yeah. That's the one. Yes.
Angel's the Geddon. Giant's the Wrath. Yeah. Even better, though. I mean, this card's legit.
This is the card that's going to cause lots of headaches to try
cause
when you're.
Like, lots of headaches.
When you're building decks around this, it's so hard when you're building a creature deck. You're like, well, there's not much I can do to a Kozilek's Return.
Yeah.
You know, with an emerge creature, there's just so little interaction there. Once again, Summary Dismissal might be a card that might, you know,
start to see play. But it's not really an answer. It's a Band-Aid, right? It doesn't really answer the
conflict.
Right,
but the idea is you put maybe enough pressure and...
Sure. It buys you enough time. Blue-White Spirits, man, I really want a Blue-White
Spirits. Also, if your Emerge opponents are sacking a creature and you're countering the ability and everything, it's unlikely that they're going to be able to cast another Emerge creature.
That's true. Yeah. That's true. So you buy yourself a lot of time. Yeah. So, but keep in mind, it's not an answer. It's just a way to buy time.
Right.
Okay, number one, definitely the card that came out of nowhere... And I have to admit, I kind of saw it coming.
Really,
I underrated this card.
Nahiri, you know, Harbinger.
So funny. Number one, Emrakul, The Promised End. You know, I just didn't think it was that good. I mean, I thought it was fine, and I definitely thought it was underpriced.
Right.
But I didn't think it was, like, as good as it is. I mean, it's
because we were talking about this card in just in ramp decks, right? Oh, yeah. We were just like, oh, yeah, you know. Is it going to be better than Ulamog?
Yeah.
We're not sure. Not only that, there's no Ulamogs anywhere. And nobody's playing with the card Ulamog.
And it was like, what do we think the average cost would be? Oh, you know, 9. You probably get it down for 9 pretty easily.
Nope. Owen has been casting this for 7. No big deal.
No big deal.
7 mana, Mindslaver 13/13.
Yeah. You might want to take that.
Might want to give that a little consideration.
Could be good. Yes. Yeah. No. Emrakul is the real deal. No question about it.
We definitely, you know, of the decks that we, you know, missed, you know, we tried out various Emerge strategies and Delirium decks, but we really did not play a lot with the card Emrakul. And, I mean, it was all over the place. And, you know, talking to other teams who, you know, were playing this, they're like, I don't know why you guys didn't come up with this deck. And we said we didn't have Emrakul. Or they're like, yeah, Emrakul is really important.
Yeah.
Like, that was the reason why they were just winning all these games.
Right.
You know, just play some creatures, play an Emrakul, wrath your opponent.
Yeah, take control, wrath the opponent, win the game.
Exactly.
So, unbelievable, Emrakul, The Promised End. I have to say, great job to Wizards R&D. Like, Emerge as a mechanic, I really didn't think it was going to be as powerful.
Like, constructed,
as
playable.
Yeah, it doesn't feel that way, right? It doesn't.
Also,
feel,
Emrakul.
Yeah, Emrakul himself. So, really,
better
honestly,
in standard than old
knows.
Emrakul was.
Oh, in standard, sure, definitely, without question. So,
people were complaining about this Emrakul when they first printed it because
it's so much worse than the other Emrakul. Guess what?
Yeah.
Get used to seeing Emrakul at FNM.
Those same people
will be there. She will be
those
there.
Those same people buying Emrakuls right now.
Oh,
as
yeah.
We speak.
Yeah, she's back. And she's better than ever. So watch out for Emrakul. She'll be at the tables with you at FNM. Well, there you have it. That's our top 8 for the week. And that is our Magic TV for the week. It's good to have you back, Paul. Are you going to be back next week? Are we gonna have you on Magic
TV?
Yeah,
I'll be back next week.
Next week?
My next tournament is Grand Prix Louisville.
I actually think I'm going to be out next week. I think Elaine and I are going to go to New York, so I will not
so
be
So we
here,
might so need we'll to, a fill-in.
Yeah, we'll have to get a fill-in. Big Worm, is it you next week, or do we have the Burglar back?
Is Burglar just gone forever?
Man, Burglar. What is going on with Burglar?
Just brewing things,
not that
I guess.
He told me. Yeah, jeez. Well, that... Nevertheless, we'll find a way to make it work, obviously, as long as we have Darksteel here. And Darksteel is always here. So thank you, Humph. He's the rock that this show is built on. Until next week, I'm for Big Worm, Armando, for Paul Chion, Humph, for Darksteel Humphrey. I'm Mashi Scan, the guy on the left. Paul and Big Worm will see you next week. Thanks for watching.